Well, hello there, chaps.
The film is about the adventures and misadventures of the last concierge of the Grand Hotel Budapest before the war, seen from the perspective of this lobby boy who worked for him.
And so my life began. Junior lobby boy in training, Grand Budapest Hotel, under the strict command of Monsieur Gustave H.
Our main character, Monsieur Gustave, is this concierge who's sort of the famous kind of maestro of the hotel.
I think he's one of the greatest characters that Wes has ever written.
When I first read the script, I was thinking Ray Fiennes would be great at that.
Monsieur Gustave is very precise. He's a very fastidious person, but he has a strong ethic, which is rooted in how you serve people.
Thank you again, Monsieur Gustave.
Straighten that cap, Anatole. The pleasure's mine, Herr Schneider.
Mr. Asbusters.
These are not acceptable.
I fully agree.
The heart of the movie is the friendship between Mr. Gustave and Zero.
Hold it. Who are you?
I'm Zero, sir. The new lobby boy.
Well, Zero's on point. You know, he does everything straight by the book, and Monsieur Gustave is his idol, and he aspires to be him.
They end up becoming strong brothers in arms. That's the driving sort of duo of the film.
Zero meets up with Saoirse Ronan playing Agatha.
Agatha is Zero's love interest.
And they fall hopelessly, illogically, wildly, unabashedly in love with each other.
Will you marry me?
Yes.
One of the first things that Zero learned is that Monsieur Gustave has special relationships with the old women who stay in this hotel.
I play a character called Madame D. She is a very ancient person who loves Monsieur Gustave.
I love you.
I love you.
She's sadly murdered.
Jeff Goldblum plays a character called Deputy Kovacs.
A lawyer for Madame D. I am the executor of her will.
To my esteemed friend, Monsieur Gustave H., I bequeath the painting known as Boy with Apple.
Wow.
What? Adrian Brody plays the son of Madame D. His character's named Dimitri. He's a bad seed.
This man is an intruder in my home.
It's not yours yet, Dimitri. Only when
you're not getting Boy with Apple, you goddamn little fruit.
Monsieur Gustave then proceeds to take the painting, essentially lifts it.
That's what launches us into the story, because he steals it. But I don't think he considers it stealing, because it really is his.
The police are here.
Tell them I'll be right down.
Edward Norton plays Henkels. He's the representative of the government in the story.
He is after him, but he might actually like this guy. He's what I would call the reluctant pursuer.
The story does quickly become kind of an adventure story.
It just sort of becomes a whirlwind.
It's like a collapsing house of cards, of incidents. One thing leads to another.
Murder mystery.
Thefts. Ski chases.
Prison escape.
War coming and political struggle.
There's more.
Okay.
To the story.
I get it, go on.
Snow and guns and explosions and jail. A real adventure, like in a classic way.
We're gonna strip search every pretzel house, Wappelhut, beer garden, and especially every grand hotel from Augsburg to Zilchbrook.
There's quite a large cast of supporting characters who are played by actors who I love and that they made into great characters.
There aren't many directors who can gather this kind of company together. What a cast. Wow, you know, the company of equals. It's really neat.
Because of who Wes hires and because of the way he writes and then the way he films these things, you do end up with performances from actors that you've always loved, but you've never seen them do this before.
It functions like a caper comedy, a wonderful comedic, idiosyncratic lightness of touch with a sort of pretty serious or bittersweet undertone.
We're brothers.
It's interesting just to look at old photographs of the way hotels used to be run and that sort of thing. There used to be people who really were the linchpins, and they were connected to everything, and in that sort of world, they ran it.
How does one come by front row aisle seats for a first night at the Opera Toscana with one day's notice? How does one secure a corner table at Chez Dominique on a Thursday?
In those days, you went into a hotel and it was the hotel's job to take care of all of your needs before you knew you even needed them.
When you live in hotels, your native guide is the concierge. He knows the ropes. He knows how to do things. There's nothing they can't do. They've seen it all. No matter how good or bad your behavior, they've seen it and they've seen worse and better.
Our guests know their deepest secrets, some of which are frankly rather unseemly, will go with us to our graves. So keep your mouth shut, Zero.
Monsieur Gustave is a concierge. He's a very good concierge. He runs the hotel brilliantly.
Mr. Gustave is helped out by his fellow concierges, the so-called Society of Cross Keys.
Which is Bill Murray, Bob Balaban and Fisher Stevens, and my friends Waris and Wally.
Using their international network of skills of being able to find anything and anyone and get anybody anywhere at a moment's notice, they help one another to get Mr. Gustave out of a bit of trouble.
Listen, Ivan, I'm sorry to cut you off, but we're in a bit of a bind. This is an official request.
Right. Stand by. I beg your pardon. Do you prefer to walk?
They're not only the epitome of sweet service and refinement, but capable ninja, secret agents.
I wear the best outfit I've ever had on. As an actor, as a person, I don't care what I do. I just want to wear that costume.
Too much salt. Not enough pepper. Take over.
Wes has cultivated among the cast and the crew and everybody a feeling that's a lot like you get from the Society of the Crossed Keys, this sense of unity and, like, tribalism.
The same people come back again and again and again. It's the experience. It's the joy. It's a return to what filmmaking should be, which is a pleasure to do.
Above all, I respond to Wes. He asked me to do something before I even saw a script, and I was pretty much good with that.
I pestered him with letters, telling him how much I liked his work, and this is the fruit of those letters, I guess.
Did you want the pipe in this one as well? I mean, it's quite a nice arrival.
I got an email saying something like, how do you feel about being a 90-year-old countess? And I just wrote back, great. And that was it.
It's like being part of a repertory company, which I think is romantic for everybody.
Matthew, thank you so much.
He attracts a spectacular group in every capacity.
It kind of keeps everyone together in a way, and it's really good for the camaraderie of people.
In this case, everybody lived together in this little hotel in Germany.
You never quite knew who was going to be staying. It was like a huge rambling house party or a camp. And in that kind of family atmosphere, it's just a delight.
It's worked out pretty well. Hi, Janet. Yeah, that Marmite came. The Marmite that the man asked for came.
Six, Hugo.
Why do you want to be a lobby boy?
Who wouldn't? At the Grand Budapest, sir.
Because so much of the movie takes place in this hotel, our first task was to find a great old hotel and to then build the production around that.
A number of years ago, I decided to spend the month of August in the spa town of Nebelsbad below the Alpine Sudetenwalds and had taken up rooms in the Grand Budapest.
I found the hotels that I liked the way they were. Then we went and tried to find which ones exist and what condition are they in.
So we looked all over Central Europe, anywhere where there might still be a great old grand hotel that was just sitting there empty waiting to be used by us, which turned out didn't really exist.
Along the way, we stumbled across a department store that was empty in this small city called Görlitz.
So there's one huge atrium with balconies at different layers going up. And the production took it over, and the interior of that shopping mall has become the interior of the hotel.
Experience.
Hotel Kinski, kitchen boy, 6 months. Hotel Berlitz, mop and broom boy, 3 months. Before that, I was a skillet scrubber.
Experience
in
zero. We had to take this building and figure out the physical space of this hotel. It had everything to do with Rafe's character. One thing that I found very inspiring was just that he's very exact and very particular.
Have those been brushed and blocked?
Of course, Mr. Gustave.
Pack them in the hat boxes. Is that from Oberstdorf and Company?
I believe so, Mr.
Second trunk. Who has the tickets?
I do, Mr. Gustave.
Give them to me.
We tried to be up to that level with the hotel, things being in place and in order and polished. All kinds of other little sets were buried within this building, and then our production offices were on the top floor of it, so it became kind of this hive for Grand Budapest Hotel.
It was off-season, and by that time decidedly out of fashion, and it had already begun its descent into shabbiness and eventual demolition.
Because there's a sort of flashback structure to the film, as the audience, you first meet the hotel in the 1960s.
We knew that we wanted to shoot the 60s hotel and the 30s hotel back to back. So in effect, we created a set within a set.
We built the first one, then we built the 1960s, and then we shot it backwards and peeled away the 1960s layer and kind of exposed the earlier period hotel inside of it.
The design of the movie is almost all inspired by things in real life, and the process of preparing the movie was in part traveling to different places in Eastern Europe and gathering ideas for what would go into this hotel.
And once we lit it and dressed it and furnished it, filled the set with our hotel staff of bellboys and doormen, and filled the lobby with 150 extras, it really came to life as a real place.
What is a lobby boy? A lobby boy is completely invisible, yet always in sight. A lobby boy remembers what people hate. A lobby boy anticipates the client's needs before the needs are needed.
Every single extra looks beautiful and extravagant and very much their own character. And there's so many different things going on in a hotel, especially when you get to know the staff. There's so many different personalities and stories, people having gossips about each other and all that kind of stuff.
The hotel does sort of become a character in the movie, as you might expect.
The Grand Hotel Budapest is the last gasp of real aristocratic Europe within the culture of the grand hotels.
People used to go to some place like this hotel and they'd stay for 6 weeks, but it doesn't really exist anymore anywhere.
The film plays with the idea of nostalgia.
It's like a film we remember seeing when we were children on the television on Saturday afternoon at 2 o'clock.
Although it's a made-up place and a made-up time, the hotel represents something fine and cultivated and civilized and sophisticated from another time. What do you want?
Whatever sort of world I make in a movie, I want it to come to life. I want the world to be an invention that fits together just so, I guess.
The war began at midnight. Pfeifelstadt fell by lunch under heavy shelling, and 10 battalions surged across the long western border. High command advanced to Nebelsbad.
Every time Wes makes a film, it's a whole world, and it's not just the script. There's a whole universe that has to be created along with it. Grand Budapest Hotel takes place in Europe, a fictional part of Central Europe, a place called the Republic of Zubrowka.
I mean, genuinely magical in the snow.
The town has so much character in all these different buildings and halls and things that this town, in effect, became Nebelsbad, which is the town in Zubrowka in which the movie takes place.
It is a fictional country. It opens up all of these opportunities to do really, really fun things.
We built an entire array of documents and signage, Zubrowkan passports, we made a Zubrowkan flag.
The currency, we designed klubeks for Zubrowka.
With any luck, she's left a few klubeks for your old friend, but one never knows until the ink is dry on the death certificate.
We invented bus lines and train lines and newspapers and things we only catch a glimpse of, but each and every one of them is impeccable.
Mendel's again.
Precisely. Who's got the throat slitter?
Everything you see here is out of Wes's head, this box. He had something to do with every bit of it. And the pastries are this incredible concoction that are completely fanciful. Look, in that newspaper, the text is his. He writes all of that.
Years from now, and you can be freeze-framing your playback of it and you know, reading these newspaper articles that Wes has written from scratch.
He just falls right into this world.
2 dozen clair de lune and 6 clams. 4 lac, actually make it 12 clams.
12.
4 langoustines.
So I'm gonna interrupt. I had one thing I forgot to say, a tiny thing. Say the 12 very quietly.
Yeah, 12.
And you can overlap onto it with the 4.
He's like a fast cook, and he cooks in a wok. You know, the set is like a wok, and you new idea, tick-tick-tick-tick-tick, new take, tick-tick-tick-tick.
I like what you just said, and I think they come up with a look here and then to him. Yeah, that's it. Okay, that's it. I think it's practice.
His overall demeanor is one of enthusiasm and excitement at the world he's written coming to life.
I feel like I have a very strong group to work with who I'm in sync with. Milena Cannonero, who did the costumes, she's taking extras and tries to make each one a character.
If you asked Milena, she could tell you the story behind them. Oh, no, this is the woman's uncle. He's just here for the weekend.
She has her own idea of what the story of this person in the background is.
May I invite you to dine with me tonight? And it will be my pleasure, and indeed, my privilege to tell you my story.
The film spans a couple different time periods.
When you see the time flashback from one time period to another, you'll see the shape, the image itself, change.
We shot the 60s part of the film in widescreen and the 30s in more of a square frame. For Wes and myself, it was a lot of fun to work in that format. The compositions have been very different than what we've done before.
You see, there are still faint glimmers of civilization left in this barbaric slaughterhouse that was once known as humanity.
We worked a lot with models and miniatures that we built. The entire ski chase sequence, we built miniature trees and we flew the camera through them on skateboard wheels. And there's something about the reality and texture and character you get from working this way that is different than what you get with CG techniques.
One of the charms of this movie is that it revisits a golden age that is so gone by. It's very romantic, it's very opulent. But really what it's all about, as in all of Wes's movies, because you can strip all that away, it's still all about great characters and great people that you want to know, who are on a journey of some kind. I think that's the treat. I think that's the Wes secret.